classic pizza stuff in there for the sauce down there, and did a little. I didn't know that my great grandfather owned everything Kingsley owned. Kingsley bought all that stuff out there from my great grandfather.
That's awesome.
Bought it in 1922.
I didn't know that.
Wow. And sold it to Kingsley in 45.
Wow.
Amazing. I'd say the family didn't. And the only reason I figured found that out was from my cousin down at Classic Pizza. Mm-hmm. He's the oldest living sloth and he's football and stuff. Pretty cool.
Yeah, for sure. Wow.
Everybody ready to go? I got 6 o'clock.
Ready?
Oops.
Are we on, Justin?
Yep.
For recording?
Yes.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. We will start our council work session here on Monday, June 24th, 2024. And we always start with non-arranged participation, just to see if there's anybody that's come to share anything with us. Is there anybody that wants to speak under non-arranged participation? Is there anybody there? Is Kevin? Kevin, if you want to speak under non-arranged, please use the raise hand feature. Okay, well, if he notifies or anybody sees a hand go up, we'll come back to it. So we'll come down to the main part of our work session, discussion with the sheriff's office. Thank you for coming. The floor is yours.
Thank you for having me. I'm Derek Jackson. I'm the director of the Washington County Sheriff's Office. Here with Sergeant Green and Lieutenant Knight. We really want to come on behalf of Sheriff Queen and discuss the mental health and police services village. The Board of Commissioners recently put it on the ballot for November. And so it will be up for a vote in November. But we really wanted to come here to talk about the components that are related to Sheriff's Office. It is an overview and update on here's how the money can be used to the make sure we answer any questions you might have. And even the condition could be contact of kind of why the movement was put in place in the first place and kind of what it's been allowing us to do over the last several years.
And what allowed us to do over the last several years. So next slide, please. So just, and I'll make sure you all have a copy of this. And so there's some data in here that I won't spend a ton of time going through, but it'll give you some background information just in case you wanted to dig into it a little bit more. But the why, you know, the financial architecture, we now forget some 14 or 15 years later, but when Sheriff Clayton first took office, you know, there are lots of debates around the cost of a police service unit, how much it costs to put a deputy on the road, and what that price was that the county was charging local jurisdictions like yourself. And so there's always this debate back and forth. We knew that the financial architecture was really struggling, and there needed to be a different way to help to fund that difference between the cost and the price. In the past, the county general fund would cover that difference. And this is where the debate always came in, right? Like every year there was a debate at the county level around how much that cost versus price difference was going to be. And then how much do we pass on to the local jurisdiction? It became really contentious. And so when Jerry Clayton first came in the office, first thing he did was get everybody in the room and say, I want to know every single penny of what it costs to put one of my deputies on the road. Now, you'd think after 200 years of the sheriff's office being in existence, we would have known that. But until 15 years ago, we honestly did not know every single penny that it costs to put a deputy on the road. So some of those numbers are in here that we'll go through in detail. But just to give you some background of like why the millage was important, a big part of the police service and mental health preservation millage is just about helping to fund local police services. The other part was around what we were doing around community mental health. You know, the state was cutting dollars for community mental health. They were losing dollars. And so there are about 300 individuals that left community mental health caseloads. And you can see a direct connection to individuals who were on those caseloads without mental health services coming in and now being in our jail. So there was a direct public safety interface with them losing funding and not being able to provide certain services to individuals with significant mental health challenges. They were winding up having to be dealt with our deputies, but ultimately winding up in the jail. And so obviously for us, it was all about being mission driven. We really believe you know, finding the bad guy, arresting the bad guy, preventing crime is a big part of our core mission. But when you think about what makes a safe community, it's really about healthy and well communities. Like any safe community is healthy. And so a part of the mental health and public safety preservation village is really providing the resources that allow us to, yes, provide traditional police services, but some of the other things I'll talk about in here are all those things that allow us to prevent crime from happening or allow us to actually get people directly to the services that they need. One of the biggest things that I share with people often is our jail is one of the largest mental health providers in the county. Shouldn't necessarily be that way, but it is. At one point, one quarter, because every quarter we get a report from our medical provider, upwards of 75% of the people in the jail were on psychotropic medications. So just to give you a sense of the scope of the problem that we're talking about. We're also one of the largest substance use treatment providers in the county because so many people in the jail also suffer from substance use disorder. So it does go hand in hand with these services to actually help prevent crime and keep our community safe. So we just tried to break this down into a couple of large pockets of money. So there's been about $33 million from 2019 to 2023 from the millage that has come in to the sheriff's office. $14.3 million of that has been for police services. Next slide. And so this is to cover those costs, the difference between the price and what it costs to put an actual officer on the street. These are 2023 numbers. That $208,000 at the very top, that's what it costs. That is not what a deputy makes, so that is not a deputy salary. But when you add in the patrol car, the training, the equipment, you add in all these things, that cost to put a deputy on the street is $208,000. We call that a PSU or a police service unit. The contract price for 2023 was $170,000. And so that difference of $37,000, that's what the millage covers. Right now, the process is basically a granting process. So you all say, here's how many deputies you're going to have in the contract. And then we provide like a grant, that money comes right back to you here locally to cover that difference. So the total of those costs and contracts are $16 million. In 2023, the millage covered a little over $3 million of that cost. Next slide, please. Yes.
How many deputies is that?
We are budgeted for roughly 101 law enforcement staff. Yeah. So what you see that goes into that, and again, it's kind of hard to read on the screen. This is just some of the other pieces that go into what makes up that 170 salary, fringe, uniform, gun, fleet, some of those things, a part of central dispatch, some of the technology. So to have that body worn camera or the technology in the car, all those are the things that go into the formula that make up that $170,000 for a police service unit. Yeah.
In the past, when we were talking, like you said, about what the costs were and everything, there was a portion of the cost that was like legacy, what do you call them?
OPEB?
OPEB, yeah. Ongoing liabilities.
Mm-hmm.
So is there still a portion of that that's in there?
It should be, and actually it might be on the next slide. So there's liability insurance on there. There's some investigative stuff that's on there. So actually I did see it right at the beginning, but there's a liability line item. Right in there as well. It covers some of that cost.
Could be.
Is that what you're asking about?
Could be in fringe.
Yeah.
And also in fringe. Yeah. There's some of that in there.
Okay.
These are just some of the other things that aren't necessarily paid for out of the contract per se, but because you contract with the sheriff's office, these are some of the extra ancillary services that go into that. The detective bureau, the K-9 unit. The warrant officer, just some of the behind the scene things and extra special teams that go with the sheriff's office because of the contract. So these again are some of the numbers that are difficult to see, but they'll be in the presentation for you. This just lays out all of our contract areas and the calls for service from 2019 through 2023. So you'll see you guys are the second line there from 3,400 calls in 2019, and then it goes from year by year. A total of 14,000 calls. And at the very bottom, it just shows the percentage of the millage that is coming out directed to police services. So the first year of the millage was about 41%. In 2020, 46% of the millage. And then you get down to 2022, 36%. By 2026, it'll be 49% of the millage. So just under half of the millage would be used to cover the contract policing costs. some of the other things that the millage allows us to do, we have a co-responder unit with community mental health. So many of our calls are for someone who's suffering from a mental health crisis. And so we pull a social worker and a deputy together as partners. They ride together on shift. This was piloted out in Ypsilanti Township, which was our largest area and also had the largest number of calls related to mental health. So we wanted to test it to see how effective it was. And they've been very, very effective. You'll see just a few of the numbers. So what this allows to do, like all of our deputies are trained in how to triage a behavioral health crisis, but now you have a social worker and a police officer together to respond to certain cases, do follow up, make sure that person is getting connected to their caseworker, their social worker, because many of them are already community mental health clients. So it's a different way, just another tool, a mechanism for us to connect the folks that we are frequently interacting with and hopefully diverting them to get them the real resources they need. So it frees up our other deputies to do what they do best. And so one reason I wanted to highlight this, although it's piloted in Ypsi Township, in this next shift bid, which is in July, you'll see a second unit, which will be countywide. So you may see some numbers and data and hear about the co-responder unit being out here in your area. And so just wanted to make sure you knew that is starting coming up in the next shift bid.
So other communities in Ypsi, other states, do they provide these services, and do you have percentages of how much it's helped you be better at your job?
Yeah, and you know what? In the there's an annual report. I'll also make sure you all get that, and it talks a little bit more about the CRU data specifically. Mm-hmm. So think of it this way: what we think about is like this continuum of services. So yes, we are getting called out a lot of times to certain kinds of calls. And then we'll arrest the person, they come to jail, or in this case, maybe it's a psych ER, but it's like a never ending cycle, right? They're there for a couple of days, they get out. Right now, kind of pre and then through COVID, some of these lower level things aren't even really being booked into the jail. So you got folks who are, it's minor, but causing a level of harm in the community and not really getting the help that they need. So this in some ways is a front door to get them to the right service, to get them to the right part of government. So there's a lot of data out there that is showing about how this is actually impacting and getting them the help that they really need versus having them cycle through the jail.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So again, the millage pays for that. This one is just about closure rates of some of our more violent crime. Again, I know it's difficult to see, but I put this in here because sometimes people say, well, you're doing all these things that are like prevention focused. You know, you're being soft on crime. What I like to say is the data speaks differently. If you commit crime, particularly violent crime in Washington County, we're going to catch you, right? You're going to, be held accountable. So that first set of lines, that yellow bar is for homicides. We solve 89% of our homicides, right? The national average is in blue, which is 61%. The state average is in green, which is just over 50%. So we are well above average when you talk about like the most serious of serious crime. So we got great detectives and deputies who are really doing a great job in solving serious crime. The next set is criminal sexual conduct. Then the third set of numbers is around robbery and then aggravated assault. So you see in the four kind of most violent crimes that are out there, we are above the state average and definitely above even the national average. So in those traditional crime fighting, arrest the bad guy, solve the crime, we do remarkably well in those areas as well. Next slide. The second big chunk of money goes to emergency services. So 4.1 million of that 33 million from 2019 to 2023 went to basically dispatch and emergency services. A large chunk of that, you go to the next slide, went to building out Washington Metro Dispatch, which is out on the road. You know, we were in the space at Ann Arbor City in their fire department downtown. It didn't allow us to physically expand. You may recall years ago, there used to be a lot of dispatch centers around the county. Almost every agency had their own dispatch center, which meant that every agency had the legacy costs, they had the staffing costs, they had the training costs, they had the equipment costs. Over the years, we now have a metro dispatch center, where we wind up dispatching for the majority of Washington County. And what that does, it's like if you were renting an apartment by yourself and you're paying 100% of the freight, all the utilities, paying your rent, and then you got a roommate and you split it 50-50, same utility, same house, but now the cost is reduced because you're sharing it. Across dispatch centers, we're now sharing those costs. Ann Arbor City alone saves $1 million a year because of the contract. And across the county, we save $3.5 million. more staff, I think a better structure, because now our dispatch center knows where all the cars in the county are. You don't have to transfer to Ann Arbor or transfer to, say, Chelsea and all these other areas. You actually have one metro dispatch center. So more safe for our community, but also financially responsible as well. The millage allowed us to pay off the bond for that building upgrade. So by the end of this millage in 2026, that bond will be paid off and that center will be built out and ready for expansion as well if we need to grow into the future. These are just some of the, Question? Yes.
Yep. Just dispatch for police services or for all emergency?
Great question. So there's a big conversation these days in Washington all around. So we're just for police services.
Okay.
Here on Valley Ambulance, HBA dispatches for HBA and for fire. And so there are lots of conversations these days around what does fire do in the future? And so you may hear some of that. We just finished a report that looked at basically a 10-year kind of lookout, like what would it take for dispatch? What are we going to look like in 10 years? And so we're just starting to roll out those findings and have some of those larger conversations. But fire is done by HBA.
Yeah, I've been hearing about that from the fire chief for years.
And I think those conversations are becoming more and more vocal all across the county as well. The third kind of pocket of money is really what I get to oversee as the director of community engagement, and that's diversion, deflection, reentry services, kind of alternatives to traditional incarceration. I like to remind people that our jail is the smallest jail per capita in the state of Michigan. Most counties in Michigan have about 3 beds per 1,000 people. We have 1 bed per 1,000. And so just for a county our size, let alone how much our county grows when that student population is on Eastern and U of M and Washington's campus, we are a very small jail for the population size. So even if we wanted to, we don't have the physical space to just lock people up. Also, that's not our values, right? And so a lot of the things that have been paid out of the millage allows us to think a little bit differently about how we do this work. Next slide. So you can go to the next slide. One of the things that we do around community engagement, I'll just give you one example, is I mentioned the co-response unit, but something else we have is something called LEAD, or Law Enforcement Assisted Diversion. So think about an officer who comes in contact with someone over and over and over. We might have arrested them 8, 9, 10 times. If they were arrested 8, 9, or 10 times and they were violent, they'd be in prison, right? So someone's cycling in and out of our jail for very minor level crimes, it a lot of times comes back to mental health or addiction. So now on that 10th time that officer is dealing with them, say, hold up, wait a second. If the person who owned this business who called about you loitering outside, and if you're okay with it, how about I call out the social worker and really get you connected to the services you need, because just arresting you an 11th time and getting you right back out of jail is not helping. And as long as that person is willing to meet, that small minor level situation goes away. It's the only thing we have in our county that is the entire system, prosecutor, public defender, law enforcement, and kind of human services around the table, walking people through and managing. We have about 222 people in our county who we call high utilizers. Those people who come into our jail 6 or more times, and many of them fall into this category where it's significant mental health challenges or significant addiction. And so really LEAD is a small number of people but and really intensive, but it gives our officers another tool other than just, I deal with you today, I arrest you, I'll deal with you next week, I arrest you. And we're talking some people have been in our jail, you know, upwards of 30 times. And so clearly just arresting them and letting them go isn't doing anything. It's not serious enough for them to be going to prison or anything like that. And so this is just another tool. The millage allows pay for some of the staffing and the resources to provide that off-ramp. And again, it's just another tool in our deputy's tool belt to be able to hopefully provide an entry door into services versus trying to lock them up. And again, our jail isn't big enough if we wanted to hold these individuals for any substantial period of time. What goes hand in hand with that is community corrections. So this is all the alternatives to incarceration: tether, GPS, alcohol testing, drug testing. So folks can stay employed, stay connected to their family, but still be held accountable by the courts. So a lot of this population is pre-trial, or maybe they were sentenced to have to drug test for so long and attend classes like a sobriety court. So a big part of what we provide at the sheriff's office is all of the staff at community corrections who does all that work. this, and I don't think I have the data in this particular presentation, but community corrections has exploded over the last 5 to 6 years. Again, the courts can't lock everybody in our jail. And so these are alternatives to just housing people physically in the jail. The millage allows us, and the next slide will show some of those things that allows us to cover to be able to do that work. And we're getting close to the end, but reentry services is, you know, someone's in our jail. We often think about how can we make sure someone leaves the jail better prepared for success than when they enter the jail. If you have someone who's sitting there for an average length of stay of 13 days, it's limited on what you can do, but you might be able to connect them to certain things. But if you've been there for 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, up to a year, there's a lot you can do with someone. 85% of the people in our jail are from our community, which means they're coming back to our community. So we see it as a prime opportunity to not us at the sheriff's office do all the work, but to open the doors of the jail to let the experts come and have a connection. How might we provide treatment services around addiction? How might we make sure, and the state gives us housing vouchers for this, if someone who's homeless when they come in has a voucher to be able to go into housing when they leave the sheriff's office. So there is a number of different things we do around reentry services. These are some of the dollars that pay for the staff that work at the sheriff's office. But if you were to sit around the table with us in our reentry meetings, there's about 20 to 25 people around that table. Only 3 to 4 work at the sheriff's office. The majority are all of our human service partners that we either contract with or raise funding together with to help us do this work. And then finally, this is just the additional investments. I said we broke them up and took out these 3 large pots for this conversation. But there's about $1.7 million that goes into equipment and technology, things like the body camera replacements, in-car video, looking at, there's no way the lieutenant or the sergeant can watch every second of every minute of every body cam video. And so there's a system we've invested in, which will look for conversations with deputies and the public. If there are certain phrases or tone of inflection, if there's certain derogatory terms that are used, the sergeant lieutenant is going to get an alert. They're going to know to go review that particular video. It can be an early warning system, so we kind of correct some behavior we want to correct. But it also can help us make sure we're monitoring and not missing things, right? The technology allows us to do that. That's paid for by the millage. We did use $1.6 million for hazard pay for our staff during COVID. The county paid for about half of it. It was going to be like $5,000 a person, and the sheriff said, nope. Our staff deserve what that standard was, which was $10,000. And so we used the millage to give our staff that hazard pay that the county wasn't going to use. There's some for jail improvements, like the roof of the jail had to be improved. And some of these that I think are significant for us kind of gets into the weeds, but it's important for you to know for one reason. If the millage doesn't cover this, the county general fund has to cover it. The county general fund covers it. There are other vital resources that don't get funded, right? So this allowed us to do some things without having to take resources from other parts of county government. The diversity, equity, inclusion work we're doing, there's some community partner stuff, like some community organizations who are helping us do some of this work. And then the last one is allocated for future expenses. People always say, well, that's a large chunk of money, $3.2 million. What is it? If the millage were to go away today, there's enough money to sunset all the things we've created. And so that $3.2 million is really like, how do you slowly turn off the lights? So it isn't just a slush fund that's sitting there for us to buy whatever we want. It's literally marked for, if for some reason the millage doesn't pass, how do we start to kind of deconstruct some of the things we've done? A lot of the infrastructure, including police service infrastructure, is now built on the millage. All of the things around diversion, deflection are built on the millage. So there's a lot of things that go into that, and that's what that last one is. So again, we just wanted to come and give a broad overview so you know what the dollars have been used for to date. It's not my job to say you're supposed to like it or not like it. It's just to give out the facts. And also to let people know that the commissioners did put it on the ballot in November. So it will be one of several countywide millages that will be on the ballot for voters in your city.
How many years is it?
It's another 6-year millage.
Another 6 years.
Mm-hmm. So it's a renewal.
Yeah. Okay.
Other questions you all might have? Yes.
If anybody watches TV very much, you're not the only police department that's asking for this kind of help. I think we lost an officer in Wayne County.
Oakland.
What's that?
In Oakland.
Oakland County. Okay. So I mean, if you watch the news, there's a lot of different police departments that are asking for additional help to try to help them be better at mental health. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. And again, I didn't put all the, you know, details of the data in here, but if you just think about the number of calls we respond to that are dealing around addiction or mental health, it's quite significant. Some of the more dangerous situations can involve one of those two things. But also what we've been trying to do is just give our deputies some different tools in a tool belt. Not that they have to be the experts to solve these issues by themselves, but if they have a phone number to call, they can pick up that phone, call that social worker out, and the social worker can kind of take over. And so we tried to give a lot of different tools in the tool belt for our deputies to relieve some of that pressure and stress so that they can do a more effective job in the community.
Jamie.
Yep, thank you. Could you speak to the impact that the millage has had so far on recidivism rates?
Yeah, so I'll say this, that recidivism, when we started to measure it, say 12 years ago, was roughly 63%. And I say it in that way because there's a lot of different ways to measure recidivism. Right now, our reentry program works with some of the highest risk folks. The jail can house up to 404 people. We're not working with case management of 404 people. We're working with roughly about 30 to 60 people. And so it's hard to say that our reentry program out of these dollars is going to change the overall county recidivism rate. But what we can say is now the recidivism rate is 42% versus 63%. There's some reports out there about from Wayne State University that talks about every doorway into the system and out of it. There are about six of those doorways. And if you can put things in place to help deflect people from getting in the first place, or if they're in, to help them get out, better prepare for success, you can see a remarkable reduction around your recidivism rate. So it's a pretty complex conversation around how do you measure recidivism. Some people only measure it at, have you come back in 3 years? Some people only measure it and say, have you ever come back? A big part of our population in Washington County comes back for what's called technical violations. I didn't commit a new crime, but I failed to go to my class. I failed to drug test. I failed a drug test. I just failed to show up to drug test. And then you get a warrant, you wind back up in the jail. So there's lots of different ways to measure it. But when we look at the total longevity who come back into our jail, 42% is where we sit now.
So I guess if you were to, is there one single indicator that you could point to that demonstrates the millage has been successful to date, or what single indicator would be used in the future to evaluate the success?
That's a great question. So I think, you know, the millage is complex with so many different components. So I'll just rattle off a few. I think if we were to remember back to when, and I'm not sure who was sitting around this table back when the county was always arguing with the local jurisdictions around the cost, our deputies every year literally had to hear this rhetoric around, are we going to have to lay up deputies because our contract is going to be cut? So for one internally, you just don't have to worry about every single year this debate with you and the county and the sheriff's office around how much that price and cost is going to be. That's a significant change because it's coming out of the millage. From some hard data around some things, I'll talk about WeLive. I didn't even mention it here, but roughly 80 to 85% of the shootings in our county are retaliatory in nature. Josh does something to me, I retaliate. So what we did was we hired people and trained them who had been armed, and we send them into the hospital bedside to start dealing with the person who had been violently stabbed, assaulted, or shot. And then they actually help that person deal with that fear, anger, and trauma, so they're less likely to pick up a weapon. So since we started, we've talked to 53 and worked with 53 people, not a single one has retaliated in that way. Doesn't mean a single one hasn't gone back to jail or gone to jail, because in our county, a lot of folks who are who've been shot are kind of involved in a certain lifestyle. And so it doesn't mean that it's a magic wand and everything is perfect, but what we do know is that that program, which is funded by the millage, is having a direct relation to lowering the likelihood of someone retaliating. The same thing for LEAD. LEAD is a small group of people, those most intensive cases. I'll give you an example. There's someone who's been in our jail 50 or 60 times. Deputies deal with them on a regular basis, all minor level stuff, panhandling kind of stuff. We know that addiction and mental health is a big part of why he cycles in and out. He would never admit that he had an addiction problem. He starts working with LEAD, and then he finally admits that he needs help with addiction. We get him into treatment. He's there for about 3 months. He leaves early, So he drops out of treatment, but he stays sober for 4 months. That was the longest 4 months since 17 years old that we hadn't seen him in our jail. So small incremental wins in that case, but pretty significant for an individual who's that intensive. And so each program, we can kind of talk about what we've seen the impact of, but there are lots of, I would say, really important wins. The fact that the community correction numbers can continue to go up means that our jail is not overcrowded. It means that we're not, you might remember 15 years ago, we were loading people on buses and having to pay other counties around us to actually house the people from Washtenaw County. So community corrections, among some other things, allow us to make sure that we're not having to do that. And then the final one I'll just say about fiscal responsibility, Metro Dispatch, that allows us to save lots of money. And so just to be, you know, better fiscal stewards across the county. So although the millage generates some revenue for us to do that work, it allows us as government to work more regional. And I think that also is a win. So there's some financial stuff, some community engagement related stuff, some region related stuff. There are lots of different, I would say, significant wins because of the millage.
Keep going.
Yeah, so this, certainly I'm not an expert in this area at all. Just in past conversations with community members who knew more about this area, they talked about the long-term impacts of the closing of psychiatric hospitals.
Yeah.
And how that plays into some of what you're dealing with here. So I guess I would be curious if you could just speak to that generally. Is this partnership and sort of this funding mechanism, I guess, do you feel like this is a sustainable long-term solution to a problem that maybe was created, you know, by some other system shutting down? Do you think we need to revert back to what that older system was? Is this the permanent future best case scenario, or are we just biding our time till something better comes along?
I think that's a great question. And I honestly don't have all the answers to what we should do on a state level, but you can see a direct relationship to when the hospitals were closed and those institutions were closed, the population that our officers around the country and around the state in particular were starting to deal with. And you can also see them coming into jails and into prisons. So that had a direct relation to us. I would just say that for us, it was about, okay, what can we do? How do we do our part? And so our part allows us to the best of our ability, start tackling some of the things that the sheriff's office and county community mental health really could tackle. Is it a long-term solution? I think it does a lot. It should provide us some kind of stability and funding around these things. These mechanisms are proven to be effective and they're working. If the national landscape or the state larger landscape begins to change, I think we should reevaluate those conversations. There are things around housing right now in Washtenaw County that are evolving. It makes it harder to afford to be able to live all throughout Washtenaw County. And so those are some kind of external features that I think will have impact on some of this work. But as of right now, when you look at the lay of the land, it's really about trying the best that we can to wrap our hands around these challenges of what we really have. So there could be a lot more help from the state level and definitely from the federal level as well to help deal with some of these issues. A jail is not the place for someone who has a mental health challenge. It's not at all.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, our jail has become, and not just ours, all jails around the country have become that. But that is not the place for someone. And in fact, sometimes we can actually see their behavior get a lot worse because they are incarcerated. And so for us, how do we make sure when we get called and 911 is called and our deputies are interacting with someone, we may not be the best responder, but we might have a great, great partner that we can connect someone to.
Thank you.
In my 24 years at the sheriff's office, like when I started, probably those first 5-10 years, you almost never went to a suicide person. Mm-hmm. It just didn't happen. It was a rare thing. It was like that unicorn kind of call. Now it's literally every day that we're going to these calls. And I think it's a combination, not only of the hospitals, but there's a lot of sociocultural things that happen, mm-hmm. especially with young people and the cell phones and social media, mm-hmm. all that affects the younger population's mental health. They're one of the significant populations we deal with mental health and suicidal runs. And so like even today, one of our deputies was helping out with guy was suicidal, was the hospital. You know, suicidal deputy gets there, he's sitting on a gun.
Mm-hmm.
And so the deputy had to deal with that problem. One of the things we do with community mental health is we've got these partnerships with them that we built through, you know, some of the millage and just those collaborations that we've got mm-hmm. together. When, like, I write a lot of our training. So when I'm writing some of our training scenarios, it's a de-escalation or mental health related scenario. not only do I run it through kind of my filters, like the technical filters, how do we do it from a police perspective? Mm-hmm. I will literally take those floor plans for those scenarios, send them over to a CMH clinician, have them look at those scenarios and say, hey, what can we, what else from your perspective can we do here in order to improve this scenario? Then not only do we write the scenario that way, but then when we actually have the scenario going on at live training, we invite those clinicians to come out from CMH to observe the scenarios. Mm-hmm. So then as we're giving the all of our staff feedback on how they perform in this particular scenario, we do it from a law enforcement perspective, from a tactical perspective, how do you stay safe, how do you keep each other safe, but then also from that mental health perspective, we'll have the CMH clinicians give their view, this is what you did really well, this is what you could think about trying to do in the future to kind of mitigate this problem you came up against. Mm-hmm. So having those relationships is actually extremely beneficial to us because we are dealing with it on an unbelievable level these days. It's a mm-hmm. continuous basis almost.
Mm-hmm. It was interesting to talk about the relationship as well with SWAT.
So same thing with the SWAT team. We've got our SWAT team, which is the tactical arm of the tactical operations. And then we've got the CMT team, which is the negotiator piece of it. And so part of the CMT team, they actually have a number of CMH clinicians that are part of that team. Mm-hmm. So they work directly, they train with that team on a regular basis. So those are the people that are talking to people. So they may not necessarily be the person that's talking on the phone, the person that's in crisis that they're dealing with. Mm-hmm. But what happens is they're sitting there listening to the call and they're feeding information based on their experience and their higher levels of training. How can we best resolve the situation in the safest possible way for everybody? So by listening to that person and identifying various options for them, they can give those negotiators those extra bits of information that are really beneficial for us as the tactical side of things, like Nick and I are both members of the SWAT team, mm-hmm. to make the decisions when we're coming up with our plans, how we're going to deal with this problem, what's coming next, what do they think might be coming in, and how do we address some of those issues. But having that expertise on site and on hand all the time, again, because of those relationships we do have with CMH and the mental health side of things, is significant for us. It makes a huge difference.
Mm-hmm. One more. You just talk about the difference between that being there and SWAT versus what it is now.
So before, our deputies are trained as CMT and they go to FBI negotiator school and things along those lines. But again, they're not master's level clinicians when it comes to, you know, community mental health type issues. So by, you know, before we might have limited information as to how we, you know, how we thought things were going and what maybe buttons to push with that individual, how to reach that individual to get them to the point where it is a safe resolution for everybody. But having the clinicians there on site does help to a certain degree with identifying additional avenues that they can then take and potentially have those conversations in a way that either wear the person down or whatever mm-hmm. tactic they're utilizing to make that a safe outcome for everybody. Mm-hmm.
Thanks. Is there, and I don't need obviously specific details, but you know, you're sharing a lot of the successes of this partnership. Can you think of a time or more than one time where something about that partnership in a particular situation really did not go as planned? And can you speak to like lessons learned from that? Or I mean, I imagine is every time you've had the partnership, you said, wow, that turned out so much better than it would have, or are there times it's not?
It's one of those things where, especially like that context, like SWAT that context, mm-hmm. frequently either people will come up relatively quickly, it'll turn into an extremely drawn out time, or they will kill themselves if they're suicidal in any way, shape, or form. And I can't give you percentages, this is what happens, but anytime it doesn't end up with a safe outcome. I can only think of one shooting with a mental health person where we actually had to actually with a firearm, mm-hmm. one shooting, mm-hmm. And that was in Ipsy City a number of years ago, mm-hmm. that where part of the tactical team was involved with that negotiation. But again, it was the proximity dictated that there's some things there, definitely lessons to be learned. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to the negotiators and the piece that they do, our goal is always to create a safe resolution. As, mm-hmm. even as the tactical team, we don't want to have to go into a house and throw guns blazing or get shot. The last thing I want to see is any of our team members get hurt or injured. So again, difficult as it is for us, we are, you know, we're kind of type A, we want to push, we want to go, let's make this happen. There's things that we think tactically we could due to press the situation, but the ability for us to utilize those negotiators in that way has been beneficial. Okay.
Thank you. I have other questions about our local police services that came up at our last meeting, but I am happy like wrapping up this part of the conversation before I ask those.
Okay, if going in any direction, Jamie. So fine.
Okay, yeah. So I just, and I, it might take me a minute to pull up our packet. So we had a sheriff's report in our last packet, and just noting some really extreme increases in year over year. So I'm pulling up what we have in the current packet. So this would be showing for May, but it's showing like a year-to-date change. So citations went up 103%. And you know, medical assists are up 95%. So I guess I had the question at the last meeting, and I said, do we know what's behind the increase in citations? I know it's a question we've asked about in the past. And some people here had some comments, but they said we're having the sheriffs here in the future. Maybe they could speak to that then. So I guess anything locally we should know about citations or what's changed in?
I think when it comes to citations, because there's so many variables that are involved there, I can't say it's like one thing or just this or just that.
Okay.
But some of the barriers that do fall into that category are staff and who we have as staff here. Mm-hmm. Traditionally, you guys have had senior grizzled deputies that, you know, looking to relax the last 5-6 years of their career. Mm-hmm. That's not the case anymore. We've had so much turnover. You have a few older staff here, but then you also have a mix of brand new staff. Mm-hmm. Brand new staff tend to make a lot more traffic stops, to be perfectly honest. Mm-hmm. And then when it comes to citations, the same way. Some people write a lot of citations, some people don't, mm-hmm. because I kind of thought that these numbers would kind of come up. So year to date for 2024, overall, we're at about 11% up over the course of the year. We're at 11% citations for the year. So we're writing about one ticket for every 10 stops.
The rate is about 11%, right? Okay, which isn't far off where you were.
No, it's about where we kind of normally are. Last year, we were at 7%
right.
for the same time frame.
Right.
So that's more or less where we're at. And I think there's some variability. There was quite a few extras, like in March, there was, but somebody's making a lot of stops. When if you, I don't know, maybe it's like, hey, you know, we're making most of the stops. Right. That, but
yeah.
One of our new deputies, mm-hmm. he's very vigorous about his traffic enforcement. Mm-hmm. So he's making a lot of stops. And so I think he drove a lot of those numbers. And then he was actually off in May, which now you see the numbers were 88.
Okay.
So Ray may be a significant factor.
Right. Yeah. I just didn't know if there was some, like, we're making a concerted effort for this type of thing.
No, nothing specific. We expect traffic enforcement out of everybody. We take the complaints that the city passes along or that we get from citizens on a regular basis. But some majority of the stops happen right along Main Street, Ann Arbor. That main thoroughfare right through there, most of them happen there. But when I pull up the data maps of where they're occurring, again, the majority are kind of along that thoroughfare. But then if mm-hmm. you look, there's almost like every single intersection in the city, there's at least one or two stops going on. You're there and everywhere.
I did actually just see an article. Somebody pulled over Justin Timberlake, who was maybe a toddler when Justin Timberlake was famous. I had no idea who he was. But in the article basically said he was known in the area. He's this young whoever, you know, officer and is wanting to do that. So that's consistent with that.
Jimmy, can I
yep.
build off that real quick?
Yep.
Can you talk about staffing currently and current vacancies?
So currently, we have not filled the third day shift position for some time. Right now, Diesel just came out of the school, so he's going to be one of the day shift deputies for the collaboration in conjunction with Lowell on day shift. Generally, we're going back to what, 2 1 afternoons? Right, so back to 2 1 afternoons, we've got 3 slated. And then a midnight shift, we've got 1 currently working a midnight shift. Our other midnight car is on long-term medical leave. He sustained a neck injury in training, and so he had his spine fused. And so he's just coming back to do light duty right now. But so Bufa, those of you guys that know Bufa, he's been off for the last couple of months because of that injury. But he's healing up and should hopefully be back before he retires next year. We are down several bodies.
Okay. And then I guess to tie the two conversations together, can you speak to, I guess, the role CMH or that partnership has played actually here in the city of Dexter? Has that been relevant to us hyper-locally?
Because what the deputies can do is With the new CRU unit, they will be like one of the primary responders for that. And then next month when that rolls out countywide, so if you did have somebody that knew it was like a flag or something along those lines, or someone that was having one of those issues and they're available, they would be the primary responder for that particular call, unless they were opposite side of the county and it was something that required an immediate, you know, response or something along those lines. Then obviously the deputy can get here first and they would kind of just slow things down until they can get here and potentially assist.
Okay.
Or at any given time, there's the CMH hotline. So we call them, call their hotline and say, hey, we need somebody out here to assist us. Or if it's occasionally people that we know we've dealt with time and time again, we'll call them on the way and say, hey, we're going to deal with so-and-so again. Can you send somebody? If they have somebody available, they send them. They don't always have somebody available. It's the truth of the matter.
Right.
And then sometimes, you know, most of the time they will let us take the lead, to be honest with you. This is kind of the way we operate. We'll step in front of people and do the talking, but if we're doing anything wrong, we'll step up. Some of them are much better than others about stepping in and taking charge of the scene. But we have that as one of our tools in the toolkit.
Yeah.
I don't have the exact numbers. In the other part of the news is obviously with fun meeting them out, and I've seen them give their part of the presentation before. And specifically speak to the leadership in Chelsea, how they broke down kind of the Western jurisdiction in Walton County, how much time they're spending out here, how many balls they're getting. As well, I'm sure we can get that data or have them come present their piece to it. But specifically to your question, it is happening, right? Mm-hmm. Where they are providing the service and the backup service to us on this part of in your city.
But. Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks so much. I'm good.
Anything else for like general patrol?
I don't think so. Not really.
Love the pink vehicle. It stood out like crazy in the parade. It started the parade.
You can't miss it.
You cannot miss it. Thanks for all your support this weekend.
And of course.
Yeah, thank you for what you do.
I think this has been very helpful for us for an overview of that. Appreciate the time.
Thank you. Good to see you guys.
Thanks.
Thank you. So before we conclude the workshop, I'll ask again, is there any non-arranged participation? Anyone in the audience like to speak this evening? Or online? I guess we'll conclude the workshop about 15 minutes early and we'll start our regular meeting at 7:00. Yeah, please.
Mission. Given in transfusions for the last couple of weeks. They finally started showing signs that he's losing blood.
Some detail, we can sit down on my computer.
What's your time, Ron? How are you shows?
I got just a couple of 1 year ago.
I
thought Mr. Wiesel was getting close.
Okay.
I'll go just before here.
Is Wiesel getting close too, isn't he?
He's got a little bit more through the age.
Oh, does he? Okay.
So he's got time wise, it's good.
Age. That's what I had to wait for too.
Davish.
Thank you.
I mean, I hopefully started at 18, right?
Yeah, but I still had to put 37 in to get to 55. Yeah, yeah. All right, thanks, guys. Hey, Jamie. Thank you for the question. Thank you. Great. Good one.